in the all purple. Another sellout here at Husky Softball Stadium. Off we go on this Saturday. First pitch is a strike. Megan Shorman in the circle for the Cajuns.
And you're going to see her work a little rise ball, curve ball combination, but everything's got a little bit of an upspin on the ball. Washington's going to have to stay on top. Has good command, throws the ball with good speed.
Megan Shorman spent three seasons at Kentucky. Her freshman year was 2019. Kentucky played Washington in the Super Regional here in Seattle that year. Megan Shorman did pitch a scoreless inning in that 2019 Super Regional on this very field against the Huskies. Now in her second season in Lafayette, Louisiana with the Raging Cajuns.
This Raging Cajun team has really pitched by committee all season long. We saw that last night. Today they turn the game two over to Shorman. She's got a tall task in facing Bailey Klingler. We just talked about Klingler and her decorated career here in a Husky uniform and the fact that she hasn't been on track in the postseason. But one thing she does not do is strike out. She's one of the toughest in the country to strike out. Just five on the season, so she battles. She knows how to put the ball in play.
And a five-pitch walk to begin the game to Bailey Klingler. Megan Shorman, second team all Sunbelt Conference this year. She'll face Sammy Reynolds, one of the fifth-year seniors for the Huskies.
Sammy Reynolds really a triple threat in the box, can bunt her way on base. We saw her do that last night a little bit. Also can swing away.
Outside edge strike, says our plate umpire and crew chief Steve Gould.
Well, after giving the lead up the leadoff walk, Megan Shorman, two quick strikes on Sammy Reynolds. It's one thing Shorman has not done a lot of, and that's free passes.
Chop to first, that's gathered by Ulrich. He'll take the sure out, three unassisted of Sammy Reynolds. It does advance Klingler down to second.
Well, ultimately, after falling behind 0-2, that's a good at-bat for Sammy Reynolds. All you want to do if you make an out for your team on offense is have it be a productive out. That was a productive out because she advanced Klingler into scoring position here early in this game.
And as the crowd chants Husky, Madison Husky comes to the plate. That chant obviously serves a dual purpose whenever she comes up to hit. Cerritos, California, she's another of the fifth year seniors, all Pac-12 second team this year, was first team a year ago. Good numbers again here in 2023 for Madison Husky.
That's something Shorman can do because she has a lot of spin on the ball. Good velocity, not overpowering velocity, but it's her spin rate. She gets a whiff rate over 50% of the time. Anytime you have a lot of swings and misses, means you're putting some funny on the ball, a lot of spin.
Yeah, when we talked with Coach Glasgow about Megan Shorman, said when she's really good, works the back door well, good rise ball. Was very, very good the first half of the season. The numbers tailed off a bit towards the end, but we're hoping for one of them quality starts from Shorman here on this Saturday night. She's had some outstanding starts, had a three-hit shutout at Florida back in mid-March, did Shorman. Had a season-high 12 strikeouts and a win at James Madison late in March. So when the stuff is good, it is really good.
And with the season on the line, that's the type of performance Raging Cajuns need today in the circle from Shoreman. Well, typically, you take a look at Washington and their body of work throughout the season on offense. It's a very balanced attack. But there's no question the first three hitters in the lineup that we've seen already today, they have really carried this team. Most hits, most RBI. But to make that deep run in the postseason, you do need the bottom of the order to step up. We saw that last night. The bottom of the order, very productive in that win.
Check swing, the appeal. First base umpire Megan Raven says she did not offer at it. So it takes it to a full count. Husky 1-for-2 with a walk in game one of this super regional last night. And she takes strike three. So Shoreman records the strikeout and two away in the top of the first.
And what a time for Megan Shoreman to go to the off-speed pitch. She hasn't shown it yet in this game. It's a little high in the zone, still close enough to be called a strike, but it freezes Madison Husky after fouling off several hard pitches. It's more the timing of when she showed that changeup that was effective for her there.
So after a 7-pitch at bat for Husky, resulting in a strikeout, here's the cleanup hitter, Jadelyn Alchin. Well, after you score 8 runs and run rule your opponent in a super regional, it's pretty easy, at least it was for Heather Tarr. Same lineup as last night, with the exception of the starting pitcher. Alchin back into the cleanup spot, playing center field. Twist that one back and out of play. Alchin 0-for-2 with a hit by pitch in game one last night. Also scored a run. Megan Shoreman lets out a scream as she strikes out Husky and then Alchin to get out of the top of the first. Alicia and Matt, thanks very much. Eliminates the ball. Matt Schick, I'm stealing that line. So when you hear it from me, I will probably not give you full credit. Lindsay Lopez, veteran in the circle for the Huskies.
And you're going to see a curve on both sides of the plate. That is her best pitch. Also an effective changeup. In the regional last weekend, Lopez was the most consistent pitcher in the circle for the Huskies.
Let's take a look at the Raging Cajun starting lineup she will face, brought to you by Capital One. A few changes here. Jerry Glasgow's team, but not at the top of the order where you got Davis. But in the two-hole, Laney Crater is the DP in a bad second. There's 2 hits in last night's game for the Raging Cajuns. They stranded 8 runners on base, Carol, so they did have opportunities, including in the first inning of last night's game.
And you and I talked a little after the game. That could have been a very different game had they scored early, had opportunities all night long.
Right back to the circle, and that's a big out already on one pitch for Lindsay Lopez to get the speedy Maya Davis.
Kind of a collective exhale for the Huskies when Maya Davis is retired. She leads the nation in stolen bases. Best way to eliminate that is not even let her get to first base. One pitch, one quick out for Lopez.
Here is Laney Crater, the DP, batting in the two hole, taking a strike from Lopez. Old Mines, Missouri, which is about an hour south of St. Louis. Number two.
Lopez has that sneaky speed. She's got a real rhythmic release. A little bit of a slower arm circle, but she is very powerful in her bottom half, and that ball can get on a hitter very, very quickly.
Yeah. Lindsay Lopez in her first season with Washington after three seasons at Arizona State. Her freshman season was 2020, so she does have a year of eligibility left after this season. But we talked to her a couple of days ago, Carol, about switching teams from the Pac-12, from Arizona State to UW.
It was a big challenge for her. Really took her a while to settle in. And, you know, 3 years is a long time to be with the same pitching coach. Of course, Tricia Ford at the time, who's now the head coach at Texas A&M. And just had an adjustment, especially just coming to a new school, new team. And it took her a little while. But I'll tell you what, the last month of the season, she has settled in. She is fresh. And she gives Washington another ace-type arm in the circle. Another thing you need to make a deep postseason run, along with that bottom-of-the-order offensive production.
Pitching coach Lance Glasso likes what he's seen from Lopez recently, who was first-team All-Pac-12 last year for Arizona State. Well, stroke down the left-field side, foul. For the Sun Devils last year, Lopez led them in innings pitched and saves, and again, was first-team All-Pac-12.
And one of the conversations, you know, Coach Tarr had with her heading into April and now into May is, look, we need, your team needs you. We need you to step up. And she has risen to the occasion so far in the postseason.
Crater bounces another one foul. Andy Crater, who I mentioned is from Missouri, from south of St. Louis. But the reason, one of the primary reasons she landed in Lafayette, Louisiana with the Raging Cajuns, her grandparents live in Karen Crow, Louisiana, not too far from Lafayette. And she would go down there frequently in her youth, loved the area, and winds up going to college down there. She is seeing a lot of pitches.
Battling. I mean, that's what this Louisiana program is built on. I mean, you don't get to be one of the top 10 hitting teams in the country in terms of hits, home runs. I mean, they just find ways to make things happen, and it starts with a mentality in the box.
Ninth pitch of the at-bat, a slow roller backhanded by Klingler, and not in time. So on a team that has a lot of speed, Lady Crater really is not one of those, but she beats out an infield hit.
Just a terrific at-bat from Crater as she battles, fouls, gets rid of pitches, finally gets one she can drive up the middle, doesn't have a lot of pace on it, and Klingler plays it perfectly with the backhand. But the ball was on the ground too long. Klingler had to move too far to her right. Louisiana has their first base runner.
One on, one out. Sophie Pisco's doing the catching, and she hits one past the shortstop, Holtorfin into left field, and now the Raging Cajuns. Back-to-back hits have two on with one out.
Well, Louisiana being very aggressive. Holtorf gets caught, taking a little step. You see her right there, taking a step towards second base. Not really sure why, because Crater was not in motion. It's a mistake by Holtorf as she stays at her position, plays the ball. She has an opportunity to get the lead out for sure, potentially a double play.
Head coach Jerry Glasgow's pulled out the lineup card. The plate umpire Steve Gould. Kayla Falterman is going to be used as a pinch runner at second base for Crater. So, again, sensing an opportunity here to perhaps take a first inning lead. Put a little more speed at second base in the pinch runner, Falterman.
Well, one thing we know we will see with Louisiana, they use their depth to their advantage. You're going to see pinch runners, pinch hitters. They're going to play multiple defensive positions from inning to inning. Coach Glasgow really making use of his entire roster.
Yeah! And the cleanup hitter up, left-handed hitting first baseman Lauren Allred, who saw a 9-game hitting streak and 13-game on-base streak snapped last night. Actually, just the hitting streak part. She went 0 for 2. She did have a walk, so the on-base streak has continued to 14 for the All-Sun Belt first teamer. That's going to be out of reach of Kelly Lynch trying to chase it down. It's a relatively young Ragin' Cajun team. It's a team that has won 50 games this year, the second time they've won 50 in head coach Jerry Glasgow's six seasons, the other being in 2019, and 12th time in school history they've won 50 or more. Break down that roster, you see there's three seniors, very young team.
And yet, here they are at Super Regionals. I mean, that just shows you the expectations of this program and their ability to just pass the baton, get it done. The winning is contagious. We talk all the time, it's not a rebuild, it's a reload, and Louisiana is one of those programs. Both of these programs have some of the longest standing streaks in terms of being in the postseason.
Yeah, 29 streaks for Washington, 24 consecutive NCAA tournaments for Louisiana. And Lopez gets the strikeout of Aldred, her first, but it's a big second out for the Huskies.
Well, Lopez usually kind of pitches to control the batters, feeds her defense, but does get a strikeout here as she goes up in the zone. Nice tight pitch on the inside corner. Big swing from Allred. Can't connect, and that is a key strikeout for Lopez as Washington gets to two outs.
And pitching coach Lance Glasgow out. As we look at Lindsay Lopez being a left-handed pitcher, four of the first five hitters in the batting order for the Ragin' Cajuns are lefty. Six of the nine are left-handed hitters.
And that's Coach Glasgow, again, using his depth to his advantage. I mean, if you follow Louisiana enough, you know you better not fill out your lineup card early, because he likes to mix up the batting order and mix up his defensive positions. But that's Coach Glasgow thinking ahead a little bit, wanting those left-handers in the lineup today.
If you do fill your lineup card out early, I suggest you do it in pencil. Carly Heath, Sunbelt Player of the Year, a little behind that one, ropes it foul.
It's a much more aggressive team. This is a Louisiana team we're used to seeing. Last night, Ruby Malin got ahead in the count after the first inning. The first inning was a little shaky for the freshman, and she admittedly said she had a few nerves, understandably. But she worked from ahead. She was on the offensive against this Louisiana team that's one of the best offenses in the country.
Missed a little bit up. One ball, one strike. Carly Heath's a two-way player. In fact, she's thrown a no-hitter this year for the Ragin' Cajuns. She's also had a two-homer game. That came at McNeese, the team that Washington beat here in the regional final on Sunday. In dramatic fashion, I might add. Painting the inside corner. Lopez strikes out Heath, so a two on, one out. This crowd, a sellout again. Husky fans hoping to send their team to the Women's College World Series. Ragin' Cajuns would like to spoil that party.
Something they did quite often in Baton Rouge.
They did. They spoiled the Tigers party, that's for sure. Kelly Lynch, first baseman, leads off. You know, these two programs, before meeting last night for game one of the series, had not met since 2010, when they came across one another in the Judy Garman Classic in Southern California. That was March 2010. They have played in the NCAA tournament before. 1995, Heather Tarr was a player for Washington. They went to Lafayette, Louisiana. Played at Lamson Park. Now keep in mind, that's pre-Super Regional, so eight teams went to the regional then, and the winner of the regional went to the Women's College World Series, and the Ragin' Cajuns won that regional and went to the Women's College World Series that year in 1995 for the second time in their history. They had gone in 93 as well for the first time. So a little history between these teams, but it had been a while since they had seen one another on the same field. Sherman with a 3-1 pitch.
That off-speed pitch is a good one for Megan Shoreman today. She's been able to throw it on various counts. Got the strikeout last inning against Madison Husky. Here comes back with it 3-1 when Lynch is sitting in a hitter's count. Kind of sitting in her legs.
Bouncy ball out to second base. Scooped by Stormy Kotzelnik. One gone top of the second.
What you like to see from Megan Shoreman. First batter last inning with Klingler, got behind, wasn't able to come back, had the leadoff walk. Same thing happened in this inning with Lynch. She's able to fight back and get the out.
Silent Raid Espinosa. Well, the last time the University of Washington made the Women's College World Series in 2019. There are four players remaining on this year's squad that were on the team in 2019, and Silent Ryan Espinosa is one of those four. One ball, one strike. So Espinosa, one of the four that went in 2019. The other three there, you see Sammy Reynolds, Madison Husky, and Megan Vandergrift. So there's the four. And on the squad last time they went to Oklahoma City. That ball's driven to center, but a few steps to her left, Maya Davis making the catch for the second out. You know, the wind had been swirling earlier, and it was really breezy. It has quit. You know, an hour ago, that ball might have gone out of the ballpark. Who knows? We'll never know, but a little bit of wind, but the flag down the right field line is not really moving at all. And it was really breezy earlier. We could hardly keep the papers on our desk here in the press box.
And that flag was holding on for dear life when we were walking in a completely different day an hour later.
Now it sends up Sydney Stewart doing the catching again. Had a big hit, a two-run home run. Gave him a 3-0 lead last night. Sophie Piscos, who's doing the catching for the Raging Cajuns, out to talk to her pitcher, Shoreman.
Well, this is the game that, I mean, it's win or go home if you're Louisiana. So every pitch matters. So important for the battery to be on the same page, how they're going to attack hitters. Remember, Stewart had the big home run last night to really break the game open.
When I heard two hits last night, jumps on the first pitch, hits it foul. And of course, Stewart batting in the seventh spot, so she was part of that 6 through 9 hitters that were so effective last night for the Huskies.
I mean, and they scored 8 runs, and the 8 RBI came from those hitters. It was just an unbelievable performance.
So last night, the first time through the order, the 6 through 9 hitters didn't reach base. But after that, you couldn't get them out, which is why we had to score this game going to the bottom of the fourth for a 5-run fourth for UW. And then they added the 3 in the fifth to end the game.
Shoreman really working both sides of the plate. Hasn't really worked down in the zone too much. That's really not her strength. It's more up in the zone. A little bit of an upspin. She gets a ton of fly ball out. Almost a 2-to-1 fly ball to ground ball out ratio. And when you're playing defense, Louisiana does not have a strong defense. That's definitely not their strength. And so when you can generate some fly ball outs, only one player has to make the play versus two. That should really help the Louisiana defense, who really struggled last night.
Stewart takes high, and when one of those outfielders is the speedy Maya Davis that can cover a lot of ground in center, those fly balls, if they stay in the park, many times are going to be turned into outs. Raging Cajuns had two errors last night. They came on the same play. They were throwing errors late in the game. Well, you saw Shorman give hand signals to the catcher like she had changed the call from the dugout, was calling her own pitch there.
Yeah, a lot of times, you know, obviously the pitcher has the final say, even though the pitches are coming from the dugout. But Shorman really takes over, not the catcher, Piskos. If she doesn't like the call or doesn't feel good about it, she'll make her own call.
And her second full count of the inning, she gets a strikeout of Sydney Stewart, her third of the game, and sets the Huskies down in order. Lost the lead, and then with the help of Jordan Campbell, came back a 1-9-8, a wild Sunday. And you probably know what happened with Washington and McNeese. So what a crazy Sunday it was 6 days ago. And Jordan Campbell, in the two games they played against LSU on Sunday, had a three-run homer and a grand slam. You know, think about, if you looked at the matchups, if you're just going to move the national seeds up, you're thinking, oh, hey, LSU's probably going to play a super at Washington. And then LSU gets eliminated by Louisiana. Now you're thinking, well, Louisiana is going to come to Seattle. But then Washington's down 6-0 and down to their last three outs to McNeese. And you're thinking, it's looking like McNeese is going to play a super at Louisiana. And then the Huskies have a comeback for the ages and score seven times. And that's the matchup we have, Raging Cajuns here in Seattle against the Huskies.
And we were scratching our head thinking, I don't think there's two other teams who rolled into Supers with more momentum and more fight and more grit than these two teams. That's why we've expected such a battle. Game got out of hand last night, but you can tell right now this has that same feel. Just that gritty, every pitch fight. And Louisiana has come out swinging. Megan Shorman is on her game. This is when Louisiana is at their best, when their backs are against the wall.
A ball, two strike count on Jordan Campbell leading off. Louisiana, the home team in this game, batting the bottom of the second. And an off-speed pitch, wave and a miss. Strike out of Campbell. While we have a moment, let's check in with the studio and Matt Schick. Alicia, thanks very much. We'll keep an eye on what's going on in Salt Lake here in Seattle. Scoreless game, game two of this best of three Seattle Super Regional. Alexa Langlier is batting with one out. One ball, one strike. So are we actually going to see a game three tomorrow in Salt Lake? None of the other Supers so far have gone that way.
A lot of them were very close today. I think every softball fan in America was holding their breath a little bit when Clemson was one strike away from heading to a game three, but Oklahoma in Oklahoma fashion stormed back, doing what they do, just know how to win, and heading to the World Series.
Lopez trying to get her to chase a little down and away off the plate. Langlier's would not comply. It's 2-2. Lance Glasso coming out. Brooke Nelson had been warming up in the bullpen, but I don't think this is a pitching change here with Glasso coming out, but he does want to talk to the battery, and the rest of the infield will join in.
Well, we've seen this a couple times now in this game, just how important it is to make sure you're on the same page. There's a lot at stake today. Washington wins. They punch their ticket to Oklahoma City. But Louisiana, I mean, Washington's well aware of the fight that's in the Louisiana team. And way this game is going right now, one pitch can certainly make a big difference. Louisiana's in the top 10 in the country in terms of the long ball, the home run. Didn't see any last night, but that is a rare feat when they don't have a lot of extra base hits.
So Nelson continuing to get loose. Whatever Coach Glasso was saying was bringing smile and laughter from Lindsay Lopez. So she's relaxed, ready to resume this 2-2 count to Alexa Lenglers. Just getting a piece to foul it off.
Lopez has such a smooth, rhythmic motion. Just no wasted motion. Really drives right at the hitter. Tunnels her pitch as well.
Back past the pitcher, Lopez. Holtorf unable to get to it. And Alexa Langliers is her first hit of the Super Regional.
We saw Langliers last night have some long at-bats, foul a few pitches off. This one is an outside pitch, doesn't try to pull the ball, just takes it right back up the middle. Good sign of knowing the strike zone, taking what the pitch gives you. Just finding a way to generate some offense. It hasn't, they haven't gotten across the board yet in this Super Regional.
Stormy Kotzelnik, the Indianapolis area native from Carmel. Well, the entire game, which was only five innings last night, Louisiana had two hits. They've already exceeded that. They have all three of the game's hits. Singles from Laney Crater and Sophie Piskos in the first, and now Langlier's here in the second inning.
Well, one thing Washington, they're one of the best defenses in the country. There's no doubt. They're a very athletic team, top five in fielding percentage. But one area defensively that's been a struggle for them has been throwing out would-be base stealers. I look for Louisiana to continue to push that envelope, try to move runners into scoring position. They haven't thrown out a would-be base stealer in the postseason. And Louisiana's a team that loves to run.
Yeah, Huskies 12 of 81 in caught stealing. That's 15%. You got a Raging Cajun team that has 143 stolen bases as a team, but Lopez right back to it to the lefty Kotzelnik. Gets her fourth strikeout in second of the inning.
Lopez is dealing today. Just being very efficient and around the strike zone. This pitch just catches the inside corner. That's been her best pitch today to these left-handed batters. Just can't get a barrel on it. Can't get their barrel down to that lower part of the zone.
Another left-handed bat up in the nine hole, third baseman Maddie Hayden. So of the three Raging Cajun hits, two are by the right-handed hitting Piskos and Langliers. Crater, a lefty, had an infield hit. So really, you look at that, Carolyn Lopez doing what you would expect, the lefty really getting the lefties out. And at 0-2 now on Hayden.
And she's so deceptive. I mean, she throws the ball hard, but she can move the ball to both sides of the plate, really stretches that zone east-west horizontally. A lot of late break on the ball. See that a lot with the swings and misses.
Chopper foul. So you had a right-handed pitcher, Brooke Nelson, loosening in the bullpen for Washington. And my question would be, I don't think Lindsay Lopez is close to coming out of this game. If you're getting the lefties out and six of the nine hitters are lefties, why bring in a righty?
Well, especially when she's struck out half of the batter she's faced. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Sometimes it's just a mental break conversation, keeping your pitcher focused, keeping it light. I mean, there's no doubt this is a big moment. And Lopez has been in a lot of big moments in her career, but not in this stadium and not on this field.
Huskies caught a break there. Stewart, the catcher, the ball she couldn't gather, and it went off the foot of the plate umpire, Steve Gould, or otherwise probably would have gone towards the backstop but allowed Langlers to go to second. Right to first, Lynch steps on. Three on assistant. A hit, a runner left. Now the Raging Cajuns have stranded three on base. Tiffany and Aaron, thank you very much. Welcome those of you that have been watching Utah's Rut Roll win over San Diego State, along with former Purdue head coach Carol Brueggemann. I'm Mark Neely. This is game two of the Seattle Super Regional. The Huskies won here last night 8-0 in five innings and a run roll over the Louisiana Raging Cajuns. This game scoreless, top of the third. Washington, the visiting team here on their home field, and have the 8-9-1 batters up with their DP Alana Johnson leading off. To this point, Huskies have had only one base runner against the starting pitcher for the Raging Cajuns, Megan Shorman. That was a game leadoff walk to Bailey Klingler. Raging Cajuns have had their opportunities. They have all three of the game's hits. They've already stranded three runners on base, needing a win to force a decisive game three here tomorrow. Showing bunt, taking a strike. Milana DPing for the second straight game in this series. Two hits, two RBIs in yesterday's win.
Bottom of the order made all the difference in that game one win. Eight runs scored, eight RBI, all from the bottom of the Washington order.
Giving it a look, the first baseman Allred, but out of room. Capacity crowd, they have sold out every ticket for the weekend. If we were to have a game three here tomorrow, all those tickets are sold. They were sold out last night here for game one. The weather's been ideal here in Seattle. This is certainly one of the great venues in college softball when you take into account Lake Washington behind the left and center field fence. So we're close to 70 degrees. Those are some fans over at the football stadium looking in. Otherwise they can't get a seat. Little check swing roller. It's gonna be a tough play. Throw to first will be late for Manny Hayden. And Alana Johnson, a little excuse me swing on 0-2, and she winds up picking up the first hit of the game for the Huskies. Took a little tumble pass first as well.
It's not a full swing and a swinging bunt. It's a check swing, but it's got excellent placement on it. She couldn't have placed it any better. And hustles down to first base. She's got good speed. Ball had no pace on it. And that allowed her to get down to first base. Twisted her foot a little bit at first base. Glad to see that she's okay.
Coach Tarr came out that way to get a quick word, but Johnson says she's all right, and it sends up the shortstop, Riley Holtorf. Holtorf had one of the key hits in the 8-0 win in yesterday's game, a two-run home run. Knocked in three and also had the walk-off RBI single that made it 8-0 in the bottom of the fifth and into the game. Glasso at third base. Usually Heather Tarr is coaching third base, but I'm not sure the reason why she's not in this inning. And that almost found Lance Glasso.
I mean, that ball comes quick when you're in the third base box, and you've got to pay attention. Glad that he's okay too.
Ah! It's the 0-2 pitch in the air down the left field side. The shortstop taking control and in foul ground caught by Alexa Langliers.
Well, this is what Megan Shoreman can do. Gets into a situation with a runner at first base. All of her pitches, curveball, rise ball, have that little upspin on the ball. And it's got a little bit of a late break. And that allows, a lot of times, batters will get under that ball. And it's exactly what she wanted in that situation. An unproductive out, fly ball out to the shortstop. The runner stays at first.
Bailey Klingler lines it to right. Heat comes in and makes the catch. Well, Klingler, who has been quiet so far in this Super Regional, hit a ball very hard, but run down by Heath.
Klingler, the best hitter on this team. You see frustration setting in a little bit for Klingler as she finally gets what I call a loud out, you know, did hit the ball well. Hopefully that'll give her a little confidence going into her next at bat.
So with two outs, Sammy Reynolds' turn. Sammy had the three-run double with Washington down to their last strike on Sunday to McNeese to tie the game at six. They would go on, win it 7-6, scoring seven times in the seventh inning to save their season. And about as an emotional win as any program could have. Certainly one of the biggest wins for the Huskies in their history. And a lot of that just because of the fashion of how they won the game. Down 6-0.
How they won it, all of the role players that came in and really elevated their game, the senior class, and the stakes. It was such a meaningful game. It was win or go home. And they found a way to get it done. I mean, it is one for the ages. I know I've never seen anything like that.
Runner taken off. Reynolds deep left field. Caught in front of the warning track. That's Kayla Falterman out in left, who runs it down. Hey, by the way, for those a team in the game on the Huskies home field here for game two of this Seattle Super Regional, and there's Maya Davis, who leads the nation in steals with 52, getting number 52 early in the game last night here. She was retired on one pitch in the bottom of the first, hit one right back to the circle to Lopez.
I mean, she is a true triple threat. Typically uses her short game, little bunt, little slap. If she gets two bounces on the infield, it's lights out. There's nothing you can do about it. But also can swing away, so the outfield has to play straight away and respect that power as well.
Two balls, no strikes. Maya Davis, her freshman year, wins Sunbelt Conference Freshman of the Year, but also first-team All-Conference. He takes a strike. Davis did not play at all for Louisiana when they were in Clearwater for the Clearwater Invitational. She had gotten hit in the hand in a game against Lafayette College and didn't play at all in the six games that the Ragin' Cajuns played in Clearwater, but came back shortly after that and has put up outstanding numbers. And after getting ahead of the count 2-0, now it's 2-2.
And Lopez, just her command that she has today. You can't hunt one side of the plate. You can't only look in, only look out. You also can't pick a speed. She's really mixing speeds, stretching the zone. Just an impressive performance so far today from Lopez.
Missed upstairs, not by a whole lot, but nonetheless, it's a full count.
And this is an important pitch for Lopez. The last thing you want to do is walk the nation's leader in stolen bases when your team hasn't thrown anybody out in stolen bases in the entire postseason.
Here comes that big 3-2 pitch from Lindsay Lopez. And a swing and a miss. She gets the strikeout. That is number five for Lopez. And she gets the leadoff batter in the third.
Lopez takes a little off this pitch, back to back, off speed pitches. And it's not just the speed. Look at this bend on the ball. It just falls off the table. Lopez has been a difference maker for the Washington Huskies here in the last month of the season. And she is fresh. She has not pitched a whole lot this season. And they gives Washington kind of that 1-2 punch along with Ruby Malin.
Well, Falterman, who came in as a pinch runner for Landy Crater in the first inning, stayed in the game in left field, is getting her first at bat. For the Houston area native from the Woodlands, Texas. She's got one at bat in the Baton Rouge Regional. And she has her first hit of the Super Regional. Kayla Falterman with a one-out single. That's hit number four for the Raging Cajuns.
Louisiana has depth, and they have quality depth. They'll bring batters in one after the other, put them in multiple positions on defense. This time it's Falterman, little slap hit, gets a pitch up in the zone, able to take it right back up the middle.
So catcher Sophie Pisco single to left. First time up, grounds it to third, gathered by Espinoza, out at second. To get the lead runner, Falterman, on a forced play, two outs.
It's Washington defense. Silent Rain, Espinoza really the glue of the defense. A steady force at third base, but this Washington defense is top five in the nation in fielding percentage. They have yet to make an error in the postseason this season. It makes it very difficult for teams to score.
That stroke to left and down for a base hit for Lauren Allred. Her first to the Super Regional. So five hits now for the Raging Cajuns, and they have a couple aboard with two outs.
Allred takes a pitch down in the zone. She's able to throw her barrel down quickly, and that allows her to catch the ball a little more solid than we've seen so far from Louisiana. Flared into left field.
Carly Heath fooled on the first pitch.
Well, Heath has come up with runners in scoring position. We saw it last night in the first inning. Hit a ball hard, but nothing to show for it. The inning was over. In her first at-bat today, same thing. Came up with runners in scoring position. Wasn't able to come through for her team. Carly Heath has had a fantastic season, but so far has left a lot of runners stranded in this series.
The Cajuns as a team left eight on base in their loss last night. They have stranded three so far today, and they have two more aboard here. Two outs in the third. Heath towards third, fielded on the short hop. Silent Rain Espinoza, a rock at the hot corner. That was an outstanding play to win the inning. Terry Glasgow, coach, what do you think of the swings, especially from your left-handed bats, that you're seeing against Lindsay Lopez, their lefty, today?
I think we're seeing the ball good. I mean, you look up the scoreboard, we got five hits, and they got one, but we got to get that run in. Like, you know, we're wasting opportunity and to take control of the game. You know, the whole deal is get the momentum back. I feel like we got momentum neutralized, but we sure missing great opportunities here to get runs in and really take control of the game and really have momentum squarely in our dugout. So, you know, I'm satisfied, but we're not where we want to be.
Well, coach, you've got a deep pitching staff. You give the ball to Megan Shoreman. What are you liking from her performance so far today?
I think she's been super sharp. I mean, she's really crisp for changeup working. Her breaking stuff's good. And she's really, really in command of the strike zone. I feel like she's settled in with the umpire really well. It looks really good to me.
We'll leave it there. Thank you, coach.
Thank you.
Head coach Jerry Glasgow, season six for him as the Raging Cajuns head coach. You know, I guess it's always good when you can, if you're a pitcher and you have a really good rhythm with the plate umpire. That's a positive.
That definitely helps. It definitely helps. And sometimes it does take the first inning to settle in, but I just like Shoreman's competitiveness today. I mean, he's absolutely right in terms of her command. And when you have your fast pitches working, and for Shoreman, that's a little curveball, rise ball combination, a lot of break on the ball, and you also can throw your off-speed pitch on any count for a strike, makes you tough to hit, and that's why the Huskies only have one hit so far today on the scoreboard.
That is an Alana Johnson infield hit last inning. Husky, Maddie Husky, leading off here in the top of the fourth. Shoreman got ahead of Husky. She's thrown a first pitch strike to each of the last six Huskies batters.
And that's what Shoreman does. I mean, she really has a swing and miss rate, a whiff rate, well over 50% on the season. And whenever you see that from a pitcher, it's, you know, there's some movement on the ball, and that's how Shoreman beats you. She beats you with that spin and that break on the ball.
Again, Shoreman pitched here in 2019 for Kentucky in their Super Regional against Washington. Spent three seasons with the Wildcats. In season 2-4, the Ragin' Cajuns for the senior from the St. Louis area in Hazelwood, Missouri. A 2-2 pitch. Looks playable on the infield. Third base, Hayden in the coach's box. Near it, makes the catch. One gone. Well, the Women's College World Series returns to Oklahoma City. The action begins this Thursday, noon Eastern, live here on ESPN. For more information, go to the online site, NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships, including the Women's College World Series. Ball went upstairs to Alchin. Tickets have been punched, as you see. The first couple went yesterday, Florida State and Oklahoma State. Oklahoma punched theirs. What a game they had with Clemson. Twice were down to their final strike and extended their now NCAA record winning streak to 48 games and back to defend their title for another time. Popped in the air by Alchin. Once again, the shortstop. This one came down right near the line in foul territory into the glove of Langlers.
Well, this is when you know Megan Shoreman is on her game. She's faced 13 batters so far, and eight of those batters have either been retired via the strikeout or a fly ball out. And that's when you know she's got some good movement, some good upspin on the ball. Washington's gonna have to make that adjustment, get their barrel on plane at the top of the zone and keep it there.
Two outs, bases empty. Kelly Lynch. And Shoreman to this point has allowed two base runners, walking Bailey Klingler to begin the game on five pitches. Then that little excuse me hit by Alana Johnson leading off the third.
And Washington is a team that can, we saw it, we talked about it against McNeese, they can score in bunches. We saw it last night. I mean, in the blink of an eye, they scored eight runs in the fourth and the fifth, and the game was over. But this is a very streaky hitting team for Washington. Talk about hitting is contagious on a team, but they kind of take that to another level right now.
Really the hardest hit ball so far by the Huskies, the line drive to right by Klingler that was caught by Carly Heath. And Reynolds hit her ball to left field pretty well that Falterman caught out in left center. With balls in the air, fly balls really the method for Megan Shoreman to get a lot of outs. It's a And they good pitch there.
Yeah, and they haven't been loud outs from Washington. You know what I call loud outs, where you make some noise and you're cracking the ball around the field and forcing the defense to really have some pressure plays. There hasn't really been a lot of pressure plays yet for Louisiana, and that credit goes back in the circle to Megan Shoreman.
Bouncy ball, Langlier's it short. Three up, three down. Six in a row, sent down offensively for the Huskies.
Well, I just think for us, we just have to trust what we're seeing and make some adjustments a little bit quicker. But I think she's doing a good job. So we'll give us a little bit more time and see if we can figure it out.
Well, Coach, Lindsay Lopez has been a real force for your team, especially late in the season. What's been the difference for her here in the last month?
Yeah, I think she just had a good mental switch, just believing in herself, and she's got some great stuff. Obviously, she's got a great off-speed pitch, and she comes with wonderful experience. So we love throwing her out there, and she's a competitor.
Appreciate the insight. Thanks, Coach.
Thanks, you guys.
Coach Heather Tarr, season 19 for the UW alum. Yes, five of the six hits belong to the Raging Cajuns. But as their head coach, Jerry Glasgow, told us, we've got to get a hit with runners in scoring position. They've stranded five today, left eight yesterday. Still looking for their first run of this Seattle Super Regional. They have Jordan Campbell leading off here. Jordan struck out in her first at bat. So she is just one of three right-handed batters in the batting order for the Raging Cajuns against Huskies lefty Lindsay Lopez. And that hit her. Shaking her hand, but I think that got her more just above that left elbow.
A little bit of an Achilles heel for Lopez. This is the 14th batter she's hit this season. No chance for Campbell there. The ball was in the batter's box.
I guess it did get that hand. So the leadoff batter reaches base for the first time in the game for the Raging Cajuns.
And that's just not fair. You know, you hit a batter. Louisiana's a little bit of momentum. Langlier's is digging in, looking for something to hit, and she throws that off-speed pitch, really disrupting the timing.
Langlier's liner caught, throw to first, double play. Holtorf in the right spot, and they double up Campbell, and just like that, base is empty, two outs.
And watch how quickly Holtorf gets rid of this ball. It is roped, but right to Holtorf. Quick transition in and out of the glove. No doubt about it. Huge momentum play on defense for Washington.
I would imagine if you're the Raging Cajuns right now, Carol, you have to be saying to yourself, what do we have to do?
And you have to be very careful not to get frustrated, because they are having a lot of quality at-bats. It's certainly something that's charted a lot. You seeing pitches deep into the count, or you have a well-hit ball. There's a lot of ways to chart that, but you cannot let frustration carry in. Take each bat as what it is, a new opportunity, a new at-bat, but that's exactly what can be happening for Louisiana right now.
Sissy Vasquez took over at second base a couple innings ago. She's batting for the first time. Sissy did get in at bat in yesterday's game. Coming off the bench, went 0 for 1.
Yeah.
runs in this game. Louisiana has five of the game's six hits. Crowd wanted that off the outside corner, and plate umpire Steve Gould said, no, that's off the plate.
Well, this is a fantastic location from Lopez. Just low and outside. Vasquez has ice in her veins to take that pitch. That looked good from up here.
And a 3-2 pitch takes ball four outside. So the freshman, Sissy Vasquez, which, by the way, her moving in to bat does add another right-handed stick there for the Raging Cajuns. Head coach Jerry Glasgow looking like he's gonna want to run for Vasquez at first base.
And a lot of times you think, okay, this is just going to be a re-entry of Kotzelnik. She's got a lot more speed. But with the depth of Louisiana, you just never know what's going to happen. They use multiple players in multiple positions. Very creative with the lineup.
It's going to be a pinch hitter. So not a pinch runner. It's Kylie Griffin. He's going to come up and hit. Or Sam Grader, pardon me, number 33, Grader. Batting here for Hayden. So another right-handed bat. You can see what Coach Glasgow is doing here now, Carol, and getting some of those left-handed sticks away from the left-handed pitching Lopez.
Yeah, why not? I mean, this has the feel of a game where one or two swings can make a big difference. I mean, both pitchers are really on their A games so far.
First at bat of the Supers for Samantha Grader. Played in two games in the Baton Rouge Regional, but did not have any at bats.
Well, and this is an important batter here for Lopez. You've got a pinch hitter, and Louisiana is a very good pinch hitting team. This is something they put their team into, this role, often. They've had a lot of success. The lineup's going to turn over. Grader can get on base.
Runner takes off. Throw goes down to second. Not in time. So there's the second stolen base of the Super Regional for the Raging Cajuns. This one comes from Sissy Vasquez.
And this has not been a strength of the Washington defense. They still have yet to throw out a base runner. And look how long Sydney Stewart holds that ball. She holds the ball way too long. No chance to throw out the runner.
Vasquez 5-for-5 now in steal attempts on the season. Count goes to 2-2. Now Grader, that's 144 steals and 174 attempts for the Raging Cajuns. Speed gets the strikeout. And the Raging Cajuns again have to be shaking their head. They're going to strand their sixth base runner of the game. Bring up the 6, 7, and 8 hitters with Silent Rain Espinoza leading off. First pitch goes to left field. Falterman with the sunglasses on, able to run it down. One pitch, one out.
So far, Washington not able to crack the code, staying on top of the ball. A lot of fly ball outs for Washington. And Megan Shorman's not going to change what she's doing until Washington makes adjustments.
Sydney Stewart called out on strikes, her first at bat. Peel, no swing. Well, I know what Husky fans are thinking, at least with the experience they've had over the last week. They had gone 13 scoreless innings before erupting for 7 runs to come back and extend their season, beating McNeese 7-6. And then last night, scoreless into the bottom of the fourth, they scored 5. So it's been a an offense that has gone dormant for some periods, but then when they wake up, Karolyk seems to be a big multi-run inning.
And then they just pass the bat. They are a streaky offensive team. Now, they are a very balanced offensive team. They do have this good mix of speed and power, probably a little more on the speed end, although they can hit some home runs as well. But they are a very streaky team, and you just feel like if you're Washington, you just have one, you just need one player to get it started, get the offense going.
Heather Tartt's back coach in third base, and she requests time to have a conference here with Sydney Stewart with a one ball, one strike count. City to Tuscaloosa. When we're finished, Bama and Northwestern with the Wildcats winning the first game last night. And Montana Fouts did pitch. And that's after we're finished here in Seattle. Lays down a bunt. She's going to let it roll foul. And I assume the conversation that Heather Tarr just had with Sydney Stewart did involve, hey, why don't you drop down a bunt here?
Yeah, Louisiana really playing deep behind the base path. See Allred over there at first base. She's almost on the grass at the back of the infield. And that bunt just came off the bat too hard. Not enough little touch on the ball, but you can see why that particular call. Clearly Allred's playing first base. It becomes a foot race between Megan Shorman in the circle and Sydney Stewart.
Well, Stewart was a part of that explosive offense last night when she hit a two-run home run to give him a 3-0 lead as part of a 5-run fourth. And the game was scoreless going into the bottom of the fourth inning last night. Another 1-2 pitch from Megan Shorman towards the hole. Backhand, Langliers. Nice play, Alexa Langliers. Well, they may have a few more errors than they would like, but the defense for the Raging Cajuns will rise every now and then. That's a good play.
Well, we've talked a lot about Washington's defense, but how about this play by Langliers? Drops to one knee, stays low on the ball. A quick transfer. Sydney Stewart has good speed, and she threw her out by two steps.
Eight in a row retired by Megan Shorman, the last batter to reach. Juana Johnson, who comes in here with two outs. She had a little, excuse me, swing hit. And she's out in front of the off-speed pitch. Strike one.
Well, Megan Shorman is in a groove. Good command on all of her pitches. And right now, she's able to throw that changeup, that off-speed pitch, really on any count. Not allowing Washington to get comfortable in the box. Hey, drive it now, let's go
there. Shorman with the command, running that right into the inner half. He's ahead 0-2.
Boy, you don't see too many 0-0 games deep into the game anymore, but this has been a very well-played game. Both pitchers are sharp. The defense has been sharp.
Raging Cajuns have had the better of the limited opportunities. They have five of the game's six hits. They have stranded six on base after leaving eight on base getting shut out last night. The Huskies have stranded two and have one hit. The one by Johnson in her last at bat. Strike three call, and Megan Shorman continues to cruise along in the circle. The head coach of the Raging Cajuns, I think he's thinking what we're thinking. What's it gonna take to get into the scoring column here in Seattle?
I mean, last night's shutout was only the second time all season that Louisiana has been shut out. And this is a team that puts up runs and hits and the long ball in a hurry.
Yeah, even with the loss last night, Carol, they've won 20 of their last 23 games coming into this one. And they have the top of the order up. Maya Davis. Lopez has been able to keep off base with a comebacker and a strikeout. She's 0 for 2. Davis lays down a bunt. No way. Silent Rain Espinosa played it as well as you can. But with the speed of Davis, no shot to throw her out.
I mean, you know it's coming. You know she's going to put something in the dirt, either bunt or slap. And she gets the barrel out in front of the plate, has an angle down on the bat. The ball just spins in place. And that means Maya Davis, number one in the nation in stolen bases, is on first base.
And how long before she takes off here?
Very soon.
There she goes. The ball's hit back to the circle. And a bit of a break there for the Huskies. I don't think there was any way they were going to throw out Davis stealing. They do get the runner down to second as Falterman bounced it back to the circle. But I think she could have had a straight steal there.
Washington has allowed 8 stolen bases in the postseason. They haven't thrown anybody out in those 8 attempts. And she had a great jump. I mean, she was halfway down to second base before the ball was put into play. She just kind of floats around the bases. Really a lot of fun to watch when she's on the base paths and out in center field.
Well, they've had 6 hits now with the bunt base hit by Davis to begin the inning for the Raging Cajuns. They've left 6. We've discussed the issues of the runners left on base. They haven't, though, even gotten a runner to third base in this game yet.
Well, Louisiana is a big power-hitting team, and the numbers speak for themselves, the home runs, the hits, all top 10 in the country. But when you're in a game like this, this has been a little bit of a pitcher's duel. That conversation, when you've got a fast runner at second base, you know, it could be a bunt and run, and you're trying to score on a play like that. It could be a fake bunt, try to steal her to third base. I mean, anything is on the table when you're in a game like this, especially when you're the home team. You can be a little more aggressive. Think outside of the box offensively if you're Louisiana.
3-hole hitter is up. Catcher Sophie Piskos, 1 for 2 with a single. Launches strike one.
And what Amaya Davis at second base does for the Washington infield, it just gives them busy minds. Now they've got to be concerned not only about the hitter, but what's Maya Davis going to do? She can steal third base as well, kind of can create some moving parts on the infield.
Piskos back up the middle. It's gathered by Holtorf. She gets the out. I'll tell you what, off the bat, it looked like it was hit a little harder than it was, and it appeared it may get through and into center field and probably would have scored Davis had it done so, but Holtorf cut it off and they get a big second out.
This Washington defense is so fundamentally sound. Watch how quickly Holtorf gets to this ball and throws it on the run, turns her hips toward first base to help the direction the throw is going to go. She saved a run by not only stopping that ball up the middle, also got the bonus of getting the out.
So the Raging Cajuns get a runner to third for the first time in the game. And with 2 outs, the cleanup hitter up, Lauren Ulrich. Single to left, last time up. And a good hack, 1-1.
Well, if you follow Louisiana, especially over the last few years, you know Louisiana gets their money's worth out of every swing. They are swinging aggressively. They are swinging hard. This is another opportunity for Louisiana to put a run on the board.
I tell you what, that pitch, about as close as you can get, but I think maybe Stewart, who was moving to her left and then reached back towards the middle of the plate, may have lost a possible strike here.
Yeah, you look how far Stewart moved over. Remember, it's where the ball is, not where the catcher is. That's a good pitch. The good news, you know, sometimes as a pitcher, you can get frustrated, feel like you made a pitch, didn't get the call. But Lopez, I just loved her mentality, and Coach Tarr talked about that in our in-game interview, just what a different mentality Lopez has had in this last month of the season. She's much more relaxed. It's allowed her to be much more focused. She's performing at a very high level.
Did she? She did. Strikeout for Lopez, and the Cajuns miss another opportunity. Appreciate that, Matt. And Alicia, who's going to blink first here today? Both pitchers have been outstanding. Lopez has worked around those six hits. Raging Cajuns are 0-for-6 with runners in scoring position.
I think the key for Shoreman, even though she's given up the six hits, well, they've all been singles, so no extra base hits.
Nine, one, and two batters for the Huskies. Riley Holtorf has fouled out, 0-for-1. Down the right field side, Wynn pushing it towards the stands. What a catch by the second baseman. Sissy Vasquez reaches over that probably about a 4-foot fence and took it out from their bullpen.
And hugs all the way around. Watch this outstanding catch. The wind just kept bringing it, and she actually goes over the fence. Has a good idea where she is, but really doesn't realize how close she is until the ball's in her glove. Look at that look on her face. A huge out to start the inning for the Raging Cajuns.
Yeah, big time play there for Vasquez. First pitch swing, and Klingler hit the ball very hard her last time up, but lined out to the right fielder, Carly Heath. Walked to begin the game, was at second with one out. Husky and Alchin were fanned by Shoreman to end the first inning. Those have been the only two times the Huskies have batted with a runner in scoring position. So they're 0-for-2 in that department so far in this game.
And I think just what's been so impressive for Shoreman, she's still very sharp, hitting her corner, spinning the ball. I mean, 8 fly ball outs for the Huskies so far. Just faced 2 batters over the minimum. There's been no momentum for Washington on the offensive side of the ball.
Bailey Klingler had a home run in the regional opening game against Northern Colorado. After that, she went 1-for-10 against McNeese in those games. She's 0-for-3 so far here in this Super Regional. You know, at some point, she's going to break out.
One of the most decorated players ever to wear a Husky uniform. Yeah, you get that feeling that she's due.
To right center field. There it is. Extra base hit. Klingler, she's at second base with a one-out double. She was due. She delivered her 14th double of the season.
This pure determination from Klingler as she takes an outside pitch as a curveball. And Maya Davis gets caught in between angles. You could tell she was, do I go for the catch? Do I lay back? And she ends up taking a very poor angle. That ball should have never went all the way to the fence. And that allows Klingler to get into scoring position.
Avery Hobson is going to run for Klingler at second base. Bailey gets a huge hand coming off. Thompson running at second. Right fielder coming to the game as well for Louisiana. Kramer Ushte taking over for Heath. So a defensive change here. Ushte now in right for the Raging Cajuns. Here's Sammy Reynolds. He's lined out to left and grounded to first. So it's a potential go-ahead run at second and a left-handed batter up. Raging Cajuns head coach Jerry Glasgow brings in a new right fielder. I can only assume here, Carol, that he's thinking, there's a play at the plate. I want Ushte making that throw from right field instead of Heath.
Especially in a game like this, as the game gets later, you want your best arms and your best defense in the outfield right now, not only to run down the ball, but most importantly, to make that throw.
Shot towards the middle. It's cut off. Lingler safe. Sammy Reynolds beats out an infield hit, Hobson to third, and the Huskies are in business with runners at the corners and only one out.
And Sammy Reynolds used all the tools in her toolbox. She goes to the slap, and the minute that ball is on the ground, takes at least two bounces. There's a little bit of movement up the middle from Langlears. No chance to get Sammy Reynolds. Finally, Washington has a little momentum on offense. We've seen this from the Huskies throughout the postseason. When they've been able to start an inning and get hot, they continue to stay hot.
Maddie Husky takes ball one. Well, the double by Klingler ended a streak of 10 in a row retired by Shoreman. And 16 of the last 17 she had retired. So back-to-back hits for the Huskies for the first time in the game. And a chance to score here and break this deadlock in the sixth.
Well, we've talked a lot about Washington's struggles to throw out would-be base stealers. Louisiana also, that's not a strength of theirs as well. The infield pulled in. Good time to get Sammy Reynolds in motion. Of course, you don't want the line drive double play, but there's nothing more Washington wants than to have another runner in scoring position with the heart of their lineup up.
Husky fouls it back off the screen. Big hack at that 2-0 pitch. Great speed at third in Hobson. Anything on the ground if you're the Raging Cajuns, if you're going to try to keep this a scoreless game, you got to get it quick and get it to the plate quickly.
Now that's where the pressure out is. You know Hobson's going to see that angle down on the ball and take off to score.
Right call.
But it has not been able to hit the Huskies haven't been able to hit the ball on the ground outside of the slap there from Reynolds. You know, it's a lot of balls in the air. And that's what Megan Shoreman continues to do, is pound that upper part of the strike zone. Curve ball away, a lot of spin on the ball.
Protective hack there from Husky. That would have been ball three, but she was not going to let the umpire make a decision there that could completely change the inning, and she got a piece to follow.
Oh, I love that. I mean, just a competitive at-bat here from Husky. No way she could do anything with that pitch except foul it off. She knows it's a big moment in this game. This is a fifth-year senior. Very experienced player.
There goes the runner, and Reynolds makes it without a throw. So Sammy, her ninth steal in nine tries. And it's a full count on Husky.
Yeah, he knew it was a matter of time, kind of which pitch to get Reynolds down to second base, and she caught a break by the ball getting in the dirt.
Well, first base now open, a full count on Husky. 3-2 for Megan Shoreman. Driven center field. This is going to give the Huskies the lead. Davis makes the catch to throw towards third. Hobson scores, a sac fly for Husky, her 43rd RBI. Reynolds moving to third, and it's 1-0 Washington.
Well, what an at-bat from Madison Husky. She knows her team needs the ball in the outfield. This time she stays on top of the ball much better, gets it to the outfield. Hobson scores easily, and the Huskies are on the board.
Hot shot, stepping on to get the out at first is Aldrin. But the Huskies break through. A sac fly bringing in the pinch runner, Hobson. Here on the shores of Lake Washington and Seattle, the Huskies now the 1-0 lead. They won last night 8-0 in five innings, so a win would push them to the Women's College World Series for the 15th time in school history. And Louisiana Raging Cajun offense that has had lots of opportunities. They've stranded seven. They've had at least one base runner in every inning. Now down a run with Carly Heath leading off. That's into right field, right center field, and gathered by Alchin, and Carly Heath picks up her first hit of the Super Regional. She had not had two great plate appearances against Lopez, but she comes through there for the Raging Cajuns.
Yeah, we talked a lot about Bailey Klingler on the Washington side being due. There was no one more due than Carly Heath for Louisiana.
It's Jordan Campbell's turn. Jordan struck out and been hit by a pitch. Bunted in the air, and it is caught by Kelly Lynch. You get a big out as the Raging Cajuns unable to get the bunt down. Our Sunday night baseball matchup, the series finale. Phillies taking on the NL East leading Braves from Truist Park, 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific on ESPN. ESPN Deportes and ESPN Radio. Coverage begins 6 Eastern, 3 Pacific with baseball tonight, Sunday night countdown. There goes the runner. The throw down is second, safe. Holtorf put a tag, I think, on the top of the batting helmet of Heath. We'll see if they want to challenge this. You're into the sixth inning, though. The umpires can initiate, but Washington does have a challenge here. Let's look. I think she, did she even tag her there? It's tough to tell from that angle.
Well, it's a poor throw. The throw is off the mark, and Holtorf, not really an obstruction position. She does end up making the tag. Looks like Heath's foot is in there in time. This has been an Achilles heel for Washington, and I don't blame Jerry Glasgow. Couldn't get the bunt down. We're going to steal on the first pitch.
You know, I don't know if she ever actually really touched her. I don't think she did. The left foot definitely got in. But I haven't seen anything on the replay where I know for sure that she actually touched her with a tag.
Yeah, Heath was, you know, you saw her head move back, but she was just really trying to avoid getting tagged. It all starts with a poor throw. You know, the poor throw down to second base created a really tough play for Holtorf.
And for Heath, her 25th steal in 27 attempts. And Heather Tarr now talking with the plate umpire and crew chief Steve Gould. You know, maybe she's saying, hey, it's the sixth inning. You guys initiate this. Go take a look at this.
Yeah, can you go get together? Yeah. Now, clearly, Heather Tarr still has, you know, her reviews as well. But she just wants the umpires to get together. Did anybody else see anything? Is there any reason we should do this review? I mean, this is a very important, I mean, it's super regionals. Every play is important. But as this game progresses, Louisiana's got a runner in scoring position down one. It becomes a critical runner out there.
Well, again, I didn't even see a tag on the replay. So how, I don't think there's any way the umpires that were not at second base, like Scott Tomlinson, who had the best look, have any better look at this. I would be flabbergasted if they somehow called her out.
Wait, take a look at her foot. Her foot is on the base before the swipe even comes down from Holtorf. Watch that foot. Her foot sticks a little bit, but she's got her toe on the bag.
And again, I still haven't seen her tag. So, all right, they're going to review it. And now, see, so Heather exhausted all of her. She wanted the umpires to do it. They got together. They didn't review it with the video, but after they got together and said, we're upholding the call on the field, she says, I actually want the video part of it, and I want to challenge it.
Well, the only thing that Coach Tarr can really be challenging here is the tag. Is she out on the tag? And I also wouldn't be very surprised if something changes on this call if Jerry Glasgow doesn't say, all right, I would like to challenge obstruction, because Riley Holtorf could be argued that she is in the base path before she has the ball.
Yeah, they're going to uphold the call. So it did go to the replay review center outside of Pittsburgh, and they are very quick about it. It is a stolen base for Carly Heath. So one ball, no strike count on Alexa Langliers. And Heath representing the potential tying run and scoring position for the Raging Cajuns. Washington just scored in the top of the inning on a sack fly from Husky scoring Hobson. Langliers is singled and lined out to short.
Yeah, if I'm Lopez here, I am very careful with Langliers in two plate appearances against Lopez. She has hit the ball very hard and very well. And we've got an open base here. First base is open. And you look down the batting order at the next two hitters, there's no hits in the 8-9 spot of the batting order at this point. Oh.
Strike call on 3-0. Louisiana has 7 hits, Washington 3. But it's the Huskies that have the 1-0 lead. Looking for a win to send them to the Women's College World Series. Full count.
Oh, what a terrific time for that off-speed pitch from Lopez. Langliers has been digging in. She's been able to time up Lopez all day. And at a hitter's count, throws a exceptional off-speed pitch for a strike.
Fly ball to right field. Good play for Madison Husky. Staying at second base is Heath. So Lopez gets the second out of the inning on a fly ball to right. Stormy Kotzelnik going to re-enter here to bat for Vasquez. Lance Glasso pitching coach for the Huskies going out to the circle, and Coach Glasgow is going to talk to the base runner Heath and the upcoming hitter Stormy Kotzelnik. Stormy, by the way, her freshman year, 2021, was here on the roster at Washington. Did not play. She redshirted and then transferred out for the Raging Cajuns. Here's what is at stake on this Saturday in Seattle. Washington won here last night 8-0 in five innings. So with the win, they punched their ticket to the Women's College World Series. And first since 2019, but fifth since 2013. And the Raging Cajuns need a win to force a decisive game three tomorrow. Raging Cajuns are 0-for-7 with runners in scoring position today.
Say enough about the job Lopez has done. Yes, seven hits for the Raging Cajuns, but they've been sprinkled throughout the game. And when she has needed to make a big pitch, especially with that off-speed pitch, she's had great command and she's been able to execute.
And now she's a strike away from getting out of this.
And this is a huge plus for Washington to have Lopez pitching her best here late in the postseason.
Appeal denied. I think she did hold up.
Is up in the zone. Haven't seen that a lot from Lopez today. And Kotsenek, I agree. No offering.
Playable in left, Sammy Reynolds. Raging Cajuns now 0-for-8 with runners in scoring position. And they strand their eighth base runner. After six, 1-0 Huskies. The 5, 6, and 7 hitters for the Huskies. Kelly Lynch to lead off. Washington knowing they're going to take at least a 1-0 lead to the bottom of the seventh with a chance to close out this Seattle Super Regional and go to Oklahoma City in the Women's College World Series.
And boy, wouldn't they love to have one more run on the board. When you get to the seventh inning, you're Louisiana, you think one run, we can do this. But boy, if they can get a second run, two runs can feel like 10 sometimes going into the seventh.
Jordan Campbell now in right field for Louisiana. Kotsenek back in at second base. A couple of ground outs for Kelly Lynch against the starting pitcher Megan Shoreman. Sam Landry started, went 3 1/3 innings in yesterday's game. 51 pitches, got hit with the loss. He's trying to keep it a 1-0 game.
See the shadows kind of creeping in. As the day gets a little later here in Seattle, makes it a little tougher. I mean, the ball's coming out of the sunlight, going into the dark, into the shadows. This changes things a little bit for a hitter, a little more focus. and mainly for the pitcher as well.
Let's go, girl.
A little looper out of the left will find some grass. Kelly Lynch singles. And it's hit number four for Washington.
Not really a full swing from Lynch, but it's enough to get the job done. Gets way out in front of this ball, hits it almost off the outer edge of the plate, out in front. Doesn't get a lot of power behind the ball, but it finds some grass.
Well, Heather Tarr is going to bring the speed of Brooklyn Carter out to run for Kelly Lynch. So Washington, as you mentioned, would love to get another run here, at least one. And the speed of Brooklyn Carter is one of the Huskies that's a major stolen base threat with speed of her own. Espinoza's hit the ball in the air twice, 0 for 2. Tap towards first base. Allred makes the tag, and that'll work just as well as a bunt. Getting Carter down to second.
Yeah, didn't waste any time. You knew if she was at first long enough, that green light was on. She was going to be heading down to second, but didn't need to do that. Espinoza, just such a solid, steady performer. Makes something good happen for a team, even though she created an out.
Sydney Stewart is grounded out and struck out. That's going to allow Carter to go to third. It's a big extra 60 feet there. Pass ball.
When you're in a game that's this tight, it's those little things that make a huge difference. Just a little bit lazy with her glove, Piskos getting over there to stop the ball. It pops out. And so much can happen when you have a run at third base. There's so many ways to score. You've got the wild pitch, pass ball. You've got the angle down play. There's no doubt Carter's going to have the green light if this ball's on the dirt. In the infield, the sack fly, there's so many ways to score. That little extra getting 60 feet, it's a big difference.
And a four-pitch walk to Stewart. And the Huskies have first and third with only one out. Tarr won the run for her catcher, Stewart, it appears. And she will do so with Kenzie Fiedler.
You know, this Washington roster isn't a very big roster, just 17 players this season, but they are a very versatile roster. One of those teams that can play multiple positions and has good speed coming off the bench right now. Two of their fastest runners on base.
Husky DP, Alona Johnson. Single in the third and has also struck out. Takes off, no throw. They give her second base. And wait a minute. They're going to call her out. This is going to be a huge out. The first base umpire, Megan Raven, is saying she left early. A huge play there for the second out of the inning.
And there was no need to leave early. Louisiana wasn't even going to make the throw. We have not seen Louisiana throw out a base stealer yet. Clearly, she leaves early. That is a huge base running mistake for Fiedler, who comes in the game to do just that.
So now Carter's the lone runner at third with two outs. Look ahead to the Raging Cajun seventh. They'll have the 9-1-2 part of the order due up, trailing it by at least a run. Here she comes, trying to steal, and she did! Carter, a straight steal of home, surprises just about everybody, and it's 2-0 Huskies.
Talk about manufacturing runs. Carter gets a big lead, just kind of hangs out, keeps her feet moving. No chance as she gets under the throw. What a fantastic play. What a meaningful run for Washington here in the seventh.
Well, you know, Heather Tarr over there in the third base coach's box was watching how the throws were going from catcher back to pitcher. And if there was an opportunity, I'm sure whispered to Brooklyn, hey, you got a chance, go.
Well, as soon as she took off and scored, and looked down at Coach Tarr, she just got a big smile on her face. And I mean, there's not many base runners in the country that can make that happen, have that type of elite speed. But it's also paying attention. No one was checking Carter. Piskus just tossing the ball back.
Two-two coming to Johnson. Strikeout ends the inning, but a straight steal of home by Brooklyn Carter. The Huskies pinched. So seven hits allowed by Lopez, but they were all singles. So Ruby Malin comes on to try to finish this off. She got the complete game five inning run rule shutout win, two hitter last night, the freshman from Omaha.
A power pitcher. Don't let that ERA fool you. She can beat anyone at any time. Changeup is coming along, but you're going to mainly see pure power in the zone. Loves to stretch the zone vertically. Can throw up and can throw down, making it very difficult for hitters.
9-1-2 part of the order up for the Raging Cajuns. Down 2-0 after falling 8-0. Game one last night.
Come on, Ruby! Yeah!
Right call, 1-1. This is the sixth time that Washington has hosted a Super Regional. They have won the previous five. They're trying to make it 6-for-6 in the Super Regional when they host. Fouls it, 1-2. We have mentioned that this is a very young team, Carol, for Louisiana, the Raging Cajuns. If they lose here to end their season, only three players on the current roster would be graduating and moving on. Kendra Lamb, Megan Shorban, who is the starting pitcher today, and Carly Heath.
A lot of talent. A lot of young talent on this Louisiana team.
Taking a deep breath, trying to close this out. Does have six saves to lead the staff this year. Hayden to third, short hop Espinoza, and silent rain Espinoza continues to be rock solid at third base.
She is the glue of this team. She is steady, and she can also make some flashy plays. Gets her body in front of the ball. Gets the glove down quickly. Not easy to do at the hot corner. She makes that play look easy for the first out of the inning.
So here is a Washington Huskies team that 6 days ago were down to their last strike. We're close to being eliminated by McNeese, trailing 6-0 going to the seventh inning, and they score 7 times to extend their season, and now they're 2 defensive outs away from making it to the Women's College World Series. Top of the order, Maya Davis.
And you saw the Washington team get together last time. Davis dropped a perfect bunt right in front of the plate. There's no chance to throw her out. One of the fastest players in the game this season. And a big adjustment from Washington as they have shortened the infield. Both Lynch and Espinoza halfway up the line. Just really daring, really forcing Davis to go to her slap and swing away. They're saying, all right, we're going to take away that bunt this time. We're going to see what you can do if you swing away.
Sprays it foul. 1 ball, 2 strikes.
And now with 2 strikes, the Washington infield can make that adjustment. They can take a couple steps back. Doesn't mean Davis wouldn't try to bunt with 2 strikes. But more than likely, she will be swinging away, so Washington can make a little bit, give themselves a little more room, a little more range by backing up on the infield. Just a real competitive pitch there from Ruby Malin, just outside of the zone. There is no one that wants the ball in her hands right now more than Ruby Malin. A fighter, a competitor. She's got a motor that just does not quit.
Missing again, and the count goes full. Raging Cajuns need a base runner to have a chance.
Well, this is an important pitch for Malin. If you walk Davis, it's almost like giving her a double because she's such a good base stealer. And Washington has yet to throw out a runner in the postseason, so just a really important at-bat here, both for Louisiana, of course, for Washington.
True freshman, Maya Davis, Sun Belt Conference Freshman of the Year. The battle continues between these freshmen.
You might think, well, this would be a good time for Ruby Malin to throw off a little bit of the timing of Davis, go to that off-speed. But the off-speed pitch is not the strength yet of Ruby Malin. It's gotten better throughout the season. But her strength is coming at you with the heat up in the zone and down in the zone.
On the 8th pitch of the at-bat, it's popped up to short. Holtorf squeezes it, and the Huskies are an out away. Annie Crater is going to re-enter. And bad here with the Raging Cajuns season on the line, down to their final out. She singled in the first inning, an infield hit. Lance Glasso going out to the circle, the pitching coach for the Huskies. Well, if the Raging Cajuns fall here, they will look back really at the opportunities today. Yes, they stranded eight base runners last night in losing 8-0. But it's been today where they had multiple chances against Lindsay Lopez, but she never buckled.
This 0-for-8 with runners in scoring position. And the defense stepped up when they needed to. I mean, they've made the plays. This is a Washington team that has been tight. Lopez, not typically known as a big strikeout pitcher. She did get 7 on the day, but the defense has to make plays behind her, and they have stepped up to the challenge.
Well, if Malin's able to close this out, it would be her 7th save of the season, which would tie a program record for saves in a season. In doing so, she would continue the Husky season in Oklahoma City later next week.
From Malin, just painting the corner, coming at you with pure heat, just pitch after pitch after pitch, can heat it up to 70 miles an hour. That's a big velocity change from Lopez.
Two balls and a strike.
Big moment here for Malin. But last night, you know, after the game, she visited with us. This is a moment she's been waiting for since she's been 5 years old. Just the opportunity to compete in a super regional.
It's going to get out of play, but Raging Cajuns are down to their final strike. Needing a base runner to get the tying run of the plate. Sophie Piskos is the hitter due next. 8 home runs on the season. Can Crater extend it? Or can Washington end it? For the 15th time in school history, the Washington Huskies are headed to the Women's College World Series.